There is nothing the anyone or anything can give us. Because all that we need is in you. Prepare our hearts, Lord, to you if you will. Open our spiritual and natural ears, our thoughts and our hearts, to hear what you have to say to us. Lord, in Jesus' name, I take authority of every spiritual force that is not of you. I bind it right now and I say you have no place here. Get out from among us in Jesus' name. This is the time of the Lord. Have your way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And amen. You all know that in this past week, Pastor Liesl and I, like I said, we try to take a quiet time with the Lord. And you know, if you just set some time aside with God, God always shows that God honors our effort. And truly in this week, God showed us stuff. You know, and the revelation that you get when you just sit with the Lord. Remember my message last week was stop, sit, and listen. Stop, sit, and listen. You know, in the humdrum of the busyness of our lives, we can so easily become the Martha. Remember that story?
Yes.
Busy here, busy there. And we prayed the whole week and we didn't get any message, you know, we prayed about it. And this morning, I kid you not, family, for like 3 hours, 4 hours even, maybe longer, I just sat in the stillness of God's presence. And in that stillness, God spoke. You know, I was like, geez, Pastor, what are we going to, you know, we don't feel comfortable just like manufacturing messages. Or I thought, are we going to put on a DVD? What are we going to do? What are we going to do for this message? But maybe the Lord wants me to be a bit more patient and sit a little longer. You know, there's a beautiful song by Bethel. The one line would be, Jesus is saying, no, don't go. Just stay a little longer. Just stay a little longer here with me. And maybe the Lord wanted me. Because I was fine. It was wonderful there. But maybe the Lord wanted me to sit for 3 or 4 hours. Just to hear a little bit more. And part of the stop, sit and listen. A sitting until you hear. Amen. Because sometimes if we just sit and listen, we might not hear immediately. But we have to sit until we hear something. Amen. And I think in a kind of continuation from last week, I guess it's a continuation. I'm going to be talking about Jonah. You know, so it's not a book that we often use, you know, in ministry. It's 4 very short chapters. So if you have your word, the Bible, just take yours out and turn with me. We're going to just be reading in different places from Jonah. And God's message is really clear, and I'm going to be repeating it several times as I go through this. In addition to stop, sit, and listen, God is saying stop running. Because sometimes in our stop, sitting, and listening, God tells us stuff or commands stuff of us that we don't want to hear. Amen?
Amen.
And then what do? We run. So please see this as a continuation. Stop, sit, and listen. But don't run from God. Amen. You guys know the story of Jonah. I think, you know, if you went to Sunday school, or, you know, even if you heard the story, Jonah was the guy who ended up in the whale's belly. Right? And I love the story because, you know, with most stuff about the Word of God, it raises controversy among scientists. You know, kind of the baby religion, you know, science.
Yeah.
And they're about, no, it's impossible. How could... You guys, the other day I was watching the show, Ask Pastor Liesl. There was a whale as big as an 18-wheeler truck. You know, they kept, and I was like, there you go. You know, of course the whale could have swallowed a person. Here's the thing right there. It's probably the whale's, like, distant granddaughter or something. You know, I love it. I love, you know, when people just try to disprove God and disprove the things of God, disprove the fact that this man was disobedient to a swallowed by a whale. I believe it. I absolutely 100% believe it. But let me not get ahead of myself. I'm reading from Jonah 1. I'll just be jumping around. Megan, you don't have to bother too much about that. Everyone should have their Bibles with them. Amen. Jonah 1. The word of the Lord came to Jonah. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. After paying a fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Wow. First thing I'm going to point out from that is, when you run from God, it gets expensive. Yeah, but now you have to start paying fares and stuff that you didn't want to do anyway. Okay, so what do we have here? We have a prophet, an ordained prophet of the Lord, and the Lord is asking him to do something. But because of his dislike for a place, maybe there was someone, I don't know, maybe there was someone in Nineveh he had a fight with 15 years ago. I don't know why he didn't want to go. But he chose to disobey the word of God. Amen. And the word of God was, you need to pack up and you need to go and you need to preach redemption to these people. And I was like, forget that, God, I'm out of here. I'm gone for the hills. He ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. You know, it doesn't matter where you are in the kingdom. It doesn't matter whether you're a prophet or whether you're a baby Christian. Sometimes the stupidity of what people do still gets to me. I love it, you know, it's running from God. Kind of cute, eh? I'm going to run from God. I'm not going to go to church for a while because I did something naughty, so I'm going to run from God. Wow. If it was that simple. Mm-hmm. And I can actually end my sermon here and say, if you're thinking about running away from God, don't. Because God is everywhere. Amen. And how many of us have gotten to that point in our life because God has asked more of us, especially that? Because God has asked something different of us. Because God has said, you know what, you child, you have to go to that prayer meeting, man. There's an anointing there waiting for you. Child, you've got to get up and you've got to confess, you've got to ask for forgiveness, because this unforgiveness is holding you back. Child, you've got to get up and you've got to trust me with that, whatever it is in your life. What do we do? What do we do? We're like, there's no way, Lord. There's no way I'm going to forgive. There's no way I'm going to go. There's no way I'm going to humble myself. There's no way I'm going to lift my hands to you. If you're thinking about running away from God, just stop. Stop. Sit. Listen. Until you hear. And when you hear, obey. So many people have come and gone in the kingdom, have come and gone in this church, because the choice they made was to run from God. The choice they made was often to run from a truth. Some people have run away because they don't like a prophetic word. Some people have stayed away from church for weeks and weeks because they didn't like the one thing I said in a sermon or something. You know? But God gets you. God gets you wherever you think you might, you know, want to go, whether it's an absence away, but God is there. Don't give yourself all of that extra work of trying to avoid God. The kingdom is riddled with mantles, with callings, with offices, with people who have rejected the Lord. The kingdom is riddled with story after story of people who have turned their backs on God. Who have turned their backs on the call of God to go deeper. The kingdom is riddled with people who have drawn the line in the sand and said, Lord, I will go to this point, but no further. The kingdom is riddled with such. And Jonah left and he fled from the Lord and went to Tarshish, verse 4. Then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. People think that by leaving the church or by running away from God, that their situation will pump down a little bit. But what happens? this. You end up on a ship, there's a storm, there's chaos all around you, and now you don't know where to turn. When the Lord speaks to us, when the Lord asks something of us, we have to obey. Because on the other end of the obedience is a blessing, but on the other end of disobedience is a crazy storm that can ruin everything that we know. Where are the masses of people who were once maybe in this house? Where are they? Anyone know? And I'm not talking about this house, you guys lifting it up. I'm talking about God. Where are those people who have turned their back on God? You want to tell me? You know? Where do people end up when you turn your back on God? What state do you end up in? Yeah, you get by for a while. No, you might be okay. But I tell you what, there's an emptiness. There's an emptiness that causes a storm. There's an emptiness that creates loneliness. There's an emptiness that creates hunger. There's an emptiness that creates an irritability. You know? There's an emptiness that creates an uncertainty, a doubt, a clock and gone. Confusion, whatever you want to think about. And that happens in the absence of the Lord. Pastor and I were chatting yesterday. You guys know this new Empires album from Hillsong. We just listened to one song. And there's one line that's causing a fair bit of controversy, Pastor. And the line, people are like shocked that it's in a Hillsong album. And the line is, it was hell without you.
Yeah, I
heard it. You heard about that controversy. People are fuming. Even if it hurts like hell, yes. People are angry. How dare they talk about hell in a song? And the pastors, there's actually a pastor who just checks their lyrics, apparently, and he said they prayed about this for months and months, and they realized that line needs to be in there. Because what is hell? Hell is the absence of the Lord. Hell is the absence of the presence of God. And that is why some people, many of we might even know of, are experiencing hell on earth. Hell on earth, and emptiness and loneliness, and life is just stumbling from one point of disaster into the next. They just can't come right. There's no peace. There's no joy. You know, relationships are, workers are, and I'm not saying that doesn't happen to believers. But if you're constantly out of the presence of God, those things just seem worse. That emptiness is just prolonged. That restlessness. That feeling of hopelessness and of despair. And isolation creeps in. What do we have here? We have a prophet who, instead of rather obeying God and God's calling to serve, chose to isolate himself. And in that isolation, we see the chaos. Amen? You're surrounded by sailors and people on the ship. Yeah, again this week. There's still a restlessness from some of you. God is speaking. But you are choosing to push that little voice down. God is asking more of you, but you are choosing to disobey. You know? The person can say a silent amen in their head, because I know you're sitting in the room, but amen, I'll say amen. Right, hallelujah. And they threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. That's what we do. We try to expel ourselves of stuff. You know, we just try to keep busy. Right? We try to keep busy when God is not in the picture. We've turned to the other gods not working. We call uncle, auntie, mommy, daddy, no joy from anyone. You know, disappointment all around. Amen? We hope that someone would come and take us to coffee. You know, friends are all busy. Oh, now what are we going to do? You know, now you're going to work in the garden, now you're tired, now, but you're still lonely. You know? Amen? Oh, we need to get on the right boat. But you're only going to get on the right boat if you stop running from the Lord. Some of you sitting in this very room have got such great callings in your life. You know? Spirits of gifts of evangelism on you. Prophetic gifts. Other gifts of the Lord. Well, everyone has spiritual gifts. But what's happening to the gifts of the Lord inside of us? They're like dormant. Do the gifts of the Lord, the Spirit of God, laying dormant inside us, because we chose to ignore the calling in our life. The Lord has spoken to many of you in this room right now, well not right now, but many of the room right now, about serving. but serving in this house. Like, no, Lord. I'm not gonna commit. Are you serious, Lord? I must commit to a serving team? You gotta be joking. Lord, I've got a life. I've got a life, Lord. Maybe next year, right? We'll chat again. It's not funny when it's true, is it? It's not funny when it's true. But that's what we do to the Lord. The Lord has commissioned us. You see the strain that some of our teams are having here. You see it. But still, you harden your hearts. Because you're in the running mode. What if God asks me to serve on a team? What if I do serve on a team? What if I do go to Sozo? What then? What if God calls me to a deeper place of intimacy? What if God asks me to go and stand in the corner of the street and preach? What if God tells me to start healing people? Remember that time when Pastor Al said she prayed for the guy in Big and Pay? What if God asked me to do that? Oh, I'll be so embarrassed. Woo! I don't want that, Lord. Jeez, pray for people in the store. What if God wants me to pray for my colleagues? Oh, that'll be the worst. What if God wants me to love my neighbor? Whoa. What if God wants me to forgive? Oof. Oh, we can't have that now. We can't have forgiveness. Forgiveness might actually make me feel good. No, I'm not going to have that. Amen. Let that sink in a little bit. Amen. But Jonah, oh, now the plot thickens. But Jonah had gone below deck where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. And when I was preparing this afternoon, I put these sleeping giants. And then I put sleeping giant slayers. And then I put sleeping warriors. What do people do when they turn their back on God? What do they become? They become a sleeping warrior. We are all meant to be warriors in the kingdom of God, getting on, doing our work for the Lord. But no. If you say to the Lord, no, then we go below deck. Where it's safe. And below deck for you can be any place. You know the below deck. Maybe it's just absence from fellowship. Maybe you turn your phone off. Maybe you don't go to prayer. Maybe you don't talk to God. I don't know what absence, you know, below deck is for you. But the bottom line is we all have a below deck, which we shouldn't have. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Because the Lord needs people on the what do you call it? What is his ship terms? What is the term where everyone is?
The deck.
Hello. The deck. God needs people on the deck. Because there's stuff to do on the deck. You know, I'm sure we've all watched these one Pirates movie. Aren't they like 50-something Pirates of the Caribbean? 56? What number we are now? But anyway, I'm sure you watched one. And there's stuff happening on the deck. There's a guy with the sail. There's a guy mopping. There's a guy checking through a telescope. There's a guy shouting. There's a guy with the parrot. Even if he's standing with the parrot, he's doing something. But what do? When we run from the Lord, we go below deck. And we hope no one will see us. And then we become like a bear. And then we go into a long season of sleep and slumber. Mm-hmm. And I'm begging you, church. I'm urging you. You got to come out from that place. Mm. You got to come out from that place of being a sleeping warrior. How can you take your place in the kingdom? How can you do what God has given you to do? We all have abilities. We all have talents. We all have spiritual gifts. But you're choosing to keep them below deck, where you think it's safe. Because, oh no, this kingdom business, oh, it's messy stuff. It's messy. But Jonah had gone below deck where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. The captain went to him and said, how can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he will take notice of us and we will not perish. Then the sailors said to each other, come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity. They cast lots and the lot fell on Jonah. So they asked him, tell us, who is responsible? And then Jonah said, I am. You know, we don't know what has happened in the world in terms of our families or our communities or our workplace. We don't know what has happened because of the result of us not doing what God has asked us to do. I'll say that again. We don't know what has happened or not happened in the lives of the people around us because we have disobeyed God. We don't know why God brought a certain person into our life, we neither. We don't know why God brings people into our lives now. But how different will one person's life maybe have been? Maybe that guy God asked you to pray for would be completely. Maybe that neighbor that God did put on your heart to take some groceries. Maybe that family member that really, really hurt you all those years ago, and yet God told you to pick up the phone and start the conversation. Maybe that person who, in the depths of your heart, hurt you so badly, God says you've got to forgive. How different will other people's lives have been, maybe our own lives, if we had just done what God had told us to do at a point? You know what the people of God are? People of God are world changers. The people of God are planet shakers. The people of God are history makers, His story makers. Okay, I'll say it again. The people of God are His story makers. But how are you going to make His story if you don't do what He's asking you to do? You know? We've got to get with the program of the Lord. And there's not one person in this room that can tell me they don't know what God wants from them. Or they don't know what spiritual gifts they have. If you don't have to do the inner mind, it's in the shape. We'll be covered there. But church, we've got to start moving. And we've got to start listening instead of running. Because when you run from God, people's lives are often made more difficult. And the biggest person being you. We gotta, you know, there's a line, and how many of you have seen Kingdom Come? Crazy movie about a funeral, and LL Cool J and Whoopi Goldberg. And anyway, there's this one line where that the mom, she picks up the phone, it's hilarious. And her son is like all drunk and he's all smoking. He's got a prostitute next to him and stuff. And she picks up the phone and she's saying, "Blessed Assurance, Jesus." You know the African American. You know that laughs. I love it. And then she starts hitting the phone with the spoon. She's like, "Come on, wake up now, wake up. The day is day. Come on, you got work to do." And he's like, "Oh, mama, you know." And he's like, she's like, "Are you there, Lena, next to some harlot? Come on, wake up, harlot." And she starts banging the phone. And sometimes I think that's what God is doing to us. We're all there, all like sprawled in some mental or physical drunkenness. I don't know. You're just laying around. And God said, "Come on, wake up now. Blessed Assurance, Jesus is yours. You've got a job to do. So rise today," or whatever the song the Lord is singing to you. God is singing you a song. And that song is about your purpose. But we choose just to be laying around here, you know? You got to start obeying, family. And then one of the other lines in the movie, the one part the guy says, you know, he wants to turn over his life, and he says to his mom, "You know what, Mom? I have to cut off this foolishness." And I believe that's what God is saying to us today. Cut out this foolishness. Cut out this foolishness of running from me, because it's stupid. It's stupid. Because it causes chaos. It's stupid because there's no better place than being in the plan of the Lord. You know? You heard the testimony of Siska and Yoni and those guys who've been in so-and-so. And I've been there. I've been healed of many things. And I believe I'm going to be healed some more. You know, when we get there. And God wants to do that. God wants to heal us. God wants to reveal things to us. He wants to impart things into us. But you're like, "No. I'm laying here. In all of my smoke and whatever. Cut all this foolishness, family." Of course it is. It's foolishness. It's foolishness to try and run from God. It's foolishness to try and run from your calling. Calling is not only for pastors. We are all, if you remember my sermon from a few weeks ago, all ministers of the new covenant of Jesus Christ. That is not limited to a mantle and office. We are all born into the kingdom, which means we are all ministers of Jesus Christ. Start stepping into your ministry. Start stepping into that area, be it a prayer ministry, be it if the Lord just wants you to take groceries. Maybe you've got an animal ministry, I don't know. but start moving in your calling. And then we know the story where Jonah tells the people, pick me up and throw me into the sea, and there will be calm. I'm going to read from chapter 2, Jonah's prayer. From inside the fish, Jonah prayed to the Lord, his God. He said, in my distress, I called the Lord, and he answered me. From the depths of the grave, I call for help, and you listen to my cry. God is waiting for us to come to that point of repentance from running. And you know what running does? Makes you tired. Like really, really tired. To the point where you actually do drop. And you're like, Lord, I've had enough. And this is the point where Jonah's at now. But my question to you guys is, how much longer are you still going to run before you get to that point? How much longer are you going to neglect what God has put inside of you? Are you going to neglect what God is asking you to do? Do you have much juice left to run? Is it not getting challenging, dodging God? Is it not getting challenging, going from this way to that way, making up all manner of excuses? A lot of people don't like coming near me because of discernment. You know? The discernment of truth and lies and stuff. And sometimes it saddens me when people look me straight in the eye and they tell me a lie. Well, they think I don't know, but the Lord knows. And I hate that. Not that I don't hate the lie. I hate the fact that I'm so burdened because of someone else's lie. And I say that because then I imagine what God feels. You know? When God is asking us to do something and you look me or God in the eye, and people make up stories. We got to stop, family. We got to stop our excuses. We got to stop our lies, because it's as simple as that. You know, dodging God, dodging what God is asking you to do, dodging your calling, dodging the going deeper with God. It's lies. It's lies that we tell ourselves. And some of us are so good at the stories we create, we start believing it. Oh, you're quiet tonight. Yeah, you're uncomfortable? I like it if you're uncomfortable. That's what the word should do, cause a reaction. The lies and the stories that we tell ourselves about why we had to get on the ship becomes our reality. I mean, we don't really know what's truth and what's not anymore. Because we are on a ship. And there's the absence of Jesus. And in the absence of Jesus, there's the presence of everything else. Who is the prince of the air? The enemy. Who is the father of lies? So in the absence of Jesus, there is darkness, there is lies, there is confusion, there is all sorts of things. Don't add to the already chaotic system that we have going around us by creating lies and excuses to the Lord about what the Lord is asking you to do, family. Don't add. Don't add to the chaos of the already evil world we are in. Just stop. Sit. Listen. And obey. And I'm speaking to someone right now, but the Lord is saying, really, how much longer are you going to run? And how many more excuses do you have? I feel it strongly in my spirit now. How much longer are you going to run? How many more lies are you going to tell to get out of what I'm asking you to do? And you know it. You know that voice. You know that feeling. In my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me at that point of rock bottom. From the depths of the grave, I call for help, and you listen to my cry. I'm jumping ahead to verse 5. The engulfing waters threatened me, the deep surrounded me. Oh, and I love this. This was such a revelation for me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. Wow. Well, can you imagine, first of all, what it would look like?
guys sitting in the whale's stomach with a cloud of seaweed, or maybe just mussels and one of the little things you get in the ocean, oysters, I don't know, maybe they're all stuck to you. But the best part, I love the description, seaweed was wrapped around his head. But then what got really funny, well maybe not for you, but it was funny for me this afternoon, when the Lord showed me a picture of some of you sitting with seaweed wrapped around your head. I laughed, I think it was funny. It was. Yes, Lord, it was. But then, the truth hit me. The revelation came. I got what the Lord was trying to say. Our thoughts. Mm. Our thoughts. Our thoughts are wrapped in the wrong stuff. Our thoughts are wrapped in the wrong stuff. Our thoughts are not wrapped in the Word of God. Our thoughts are not wrapped in the things of God, but our thoughts are wrapped in layers of junk. Layers of, I mean, seaweed, when was the last time any of you needed seaweed for something constructive?
Sushi.
Oh, need for sushi. Forgive me. You know? Other than sushi, can we think of another use for seaweed? No? Chart, you bored with seaweed? No? You need it in your spirulina, I guess, you know. But I mean, seaweed isn't as, even today, isn't as a thing that we use a lot, you know. It's useless. But the Lord showed me that our thoughts, our mind, our emotions are wrapped in the useless kind of stuff. What is something that's useless? It's garbage. What is something that's useless? It's junk. So what is God saying then? Our thoughts are wrapped in junk. It's as simple as that. Hey, Claire. Our thoughts are wrapped in junk. And we have to get to this point of confession, like Jonah did. Where he says, Lord, there was seaweed wrapped around my head. Lord, my mind was clouded with nonsense. My mind was clouded with nonsense emotions. My mind was clouded with nonsense thoughts. My mind was clouded with lies, some of which I invented. My mind was clouded with excuses, especially those that I created to give back to you. We need to give God what is rightfully God's, which is praise and worship and honor and truth. God is truth, so God deserves truth from us. Cut out this foolishness. Stop the lies. Stop the excuses. We've got to stop running from God. Do what God is asking you to do in this hour, in this time. If God is calling you into a deeper prayer experience, go. If God is calling you into a deeper Bible study experience, go. If God is telling you to forgive someone, do it. How dare we, church? How dare we run from the Creator of what we do? We've got to cut all this foolishness. Because God is standing there like on a phone line, you know, tapping with a wooden spoon to get our attention, to get us awake, to get us to snap out of our nonsense. To get us to snap out of this seaweed-wrapped mentality. Uselessness. Our lives, I believe, will be so much more fluid, so much easier maybe easier, I don't know. If we just get our thoughts on the right stuff. If we just get our thoughts on the Word of God and the things of God. Corinthians tells us you have the mind of Christ. In other words, you have the anointed mind. That's my daily prayer. I say, Lord, please may I activate and move in the mind of the anointed one. The mind of Jesus. So what happens if we switch over our minds from nonsense to the things of God? The way we see things will change. You know, maybe things will get a bit rough at work. If it's seaweed wrapped, then we freak out. Maybe we start kicking the furniture, throw the fax machine, like the fax machine did something to you. You know, the computer screen's getting a punch. You know, unnecessary, you know. Poor neighbor's offering you coffee. You told her the coffee is terrible. You wanted milk, she put Cremora. You know, unnecessary stuff. But when challenges come in the mind of God, you're like, whoa. Okay, I see there's a problem here. What do you do? Calm down. Lord, give me wisdom, the first thing. Lord, give me the words to speak, the second thing. Lord, teach me what to say in this moment, you know? If you've got your mind tuned to the things of God, situations end up very differently. Yes. If you are on the right boat, situations end up very differently. Mm. On the boat where Jesus is, the storm gets calm. We get comfort, we get peace. Mm. On the boat where Jesus is not, where there's chaos and panic and fear, people get thrown overboard into whales. Yeah. Are we together, family? Mm-hmm. Are we together? Seaweed was wrapped around my head. And then we know the story. The redemption came after the confession. Yeah. But how thick was Jonah, hey? He stayed there for a couple of days. Couple of days, why? What did Pastor Al say? Pastor Al, was it last week, the other week? Pride. Mm. Pride. Pride will make us sit there and grit our teeth at God. Like, Lord, I'm not going. I said I'm not going to church. I said I'm not going to that stupid conference. I said I'm not going to be accountable to the pastor. I said I'm not going to give up smoking. Stop asking me. Oh, that's what it is. Yes, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Yeah? Sounds familiar, family. And we sit there and regret and regret. But eventually, oh, we're human, we're weak. And the absence of the Lord gets too much for us. Yeah. Whether it's on our deathbed one day or whether it's in a moment of revelation. But we must give over. We must give over to what? Not rather to what, but rather to who God is. Not to the answers or to the assignment or to the job that God is asking me to do, but to who God is. Mm. Give over to who God is. God is truth. God is purpose. You know, God is spirit and fire and power and ability and anointing and all of that. Give over to that. Instead of running. Instead of being stubborn. Stop gritting your teeth. I'm sure your jaws are getting sore. Especially the spiritual ones. Do not harden your heart. Nothing good can come from that. Nothing good can come from a further rejection of ignoring what God is asking you to do. So just stop it. It's as simple as that, really. Yes. Stop it. Years ago, when I was in the tower teaching, I think it was a grade 11 exam or something, and I caught this kid copying, and I called one of my colleagues, and you were so cool. You just came in. He wrote the report, and he looks up and he said, okay, to the rest of you who are thinking about copying or are currently copying, just stop it. That's what he said to them when he walked out. Just stop it. So I'm saying that to you today. Just stop it. Stop the running. Stop the lies. Stop the excuses. Stop rejecting God for what God is asking you to do. Stop hiding from God. The well gets smelly. After a while, stop hiding. The world gets stinky. Have you ever seen the inside? If you watch one of these Nat Geo shows, a whale or a shark, have you ever seen what's inside there? Yeah, toilets, you know, number plates and boots and that stuff gets stinky in there. Hey, come on, you really want to live out your life there? Hey, it took Jonah 3 days before the light came on. Is it not getting stinky where you're at now? Just stop it. Stop running. Stop rejecting. Stop hiding from God. It doesn't matter where you go. God is there. It doesn't matter how much you try to close out that calling. Close out the voice of Holy Spirit. Guess what? You're going to hear it. Amen. I was going to read you the story of the prodigal, but let me actually highlight it. I'll add a few things. I'm reading from Luke 15, from verse 11. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, settled for a distant country, and squandered his wealth in wild living. He chose to pack up and leave the safety of the Lord. Of course, the father here represents the Lord. You chose to rather get on a boat and go elsewhere than staying in the safe harbor of God. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his field to feed pigs. Guys, whether you're in the belly of a whale or whether you're in the pigsty, if there is no God there, it's a horrible place. But you get into the belly of the whale or into the pigsty when you turn your back on God. When you turn your back on the calling. When you turn your back on the provision. And I think this is what these two scriptures are trying to tell us. Just don't do it. Don't run. Stop running. Start obeying. And stop hiding. Stop hiding, sleeping giants. Stop hiding from who God is calling you to be. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. You know what that is? Spiritual hunger. Spiritual hunger. And what happens when there's spiritual hunger? Like I said, there's a restlessness. There's an irritability. You know? There's a rubbing up the wrong way. Outside of God. And we get hungry even for little scraps. That's why I guess some people go to different churches. It's better than being in one church. Cool. But the restlessness doesn't end. Because that's not where God wanted them to be, for example. Or maybe they choose to sit and watch stuff on TV, you know, faith, network, God TV, lovely stuff. But that's not what God said. God said, get up and go to church. Get up and go to prayer meeting. You're like, well, Lord, you know, I can listen to something here. It's just, no. It's not because it's just good or just bad. But what is God asking you to do? What happened there? We're rationalizing. Come with excuses. Well, God, you know, the Pastor Creflo is on his, you know, way more entertaining than Pastor Rush. It's not the point. It's not about who's entertaining or who said what. God is asking you to do something. And to avoid that absence, that separation, that isolation, that finding yourself in a whale's belly or in a pigsty. Stop running. Stop hiding. And start obeying. When he came to his senses, Jonah took 3 days, his fellows took a while longer. He said, how many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. Yes, it's talking about physical starvation. But what happens to us in a state of spiritual starvation? You know what? We get thrown overboard into a storm. Because we don't have the will to fight. We don't have the will to go on anymore. So we just choose the next best thing, and that is often whatever, you know, people stumble into. I've seen, you know, people of God return to a life of alcoholism after serving the Lord for years. Maybe because of the calling, I don't know, situations, but in that, they choose to go to the extreme. And what is in the extreme? Nothingness. Nothingness. I can't imagine my life without God. I can't imagine my life without the peace that I feel. Yes, stuff happens. It's cool. It's cool. But I'd much rather have stuff happening to me, knowing that God is with me and feeling that safety bubble, than going through life with everything maybe that people could ever imagine and feeling empty. You know? There's stuff that this world tries to give us. Like this young man, he thought he would find it from spending a lot of money, having a good time, you know, chilling with his friends. I'm sure he bought lots and lots of rounds of alcohol, wherever he was, you know. Maybe trying to get the popularity up a bit in the area. I don't know what they drink in Jerusalem, wherever he found himself, or if they had bar, whatever, you know what I'm saying? But eventually that runs out. Eventually the good times end. Eventually the pockets run dry. You know, things get wild. And you end up in a whale's belly or sitting in a pigsty, longing for the connection with your creator. Outside of God is restlessness. I know I'm going on for a while, but hey, three of us on holiday tomorrow, so the rest of you can't. Amen. Thank you. I love it. I love that. Thank you, Pastor.
Oh, that's right.
I posted something in the Beacon. Oh, you know, Kermit the Frog from the Muppets. Have you guys seen that? Just go and check my Facebook page. I love it. And the Kermit the Frog is looking at like his next door neighbor, and the caption reads, that moment when the pastor says, I'm about to let you all go, and the person next to you says, take your time, pastor. And it comes like, what the hey? Yeah, so the pastor was about the hey. Amen. Stop running. Stop hiding. Cut out the foolishness. Because there's something amazing at the end of that. And the amazing part is when we get to running back, Pastor, running to your arms. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's men have food to spare? I like that. Oh, thank you. That's another revelation, Holy Spirit. In the kingdom, there's always something to spare. Amen? In the kingdom, there's always abundance. And sometimes people look at us through the eyes, you know, a glass window into this happening, this kingdom life, and a jealousy creeps in. A jealousy creeps in because the people of God who are faithful just seem to have it all. You know, people are like, ah, do you hear that testimony? Gee whiz, the bank balance is going up. Did you hear that people getting healed? You're like, what's that about? And people are looking through this glass window. Sometimes you're in the church and you're still looking through a window that you created for yourself. Mm-hmm. Amen? That is because you're just behind that point of hiding from God. You're going to come out from that point, family. You're going to come out from that point of disobedience and of hiding and of trying to keep yourself in some dark little corner. So you can also have food to spare. So you can also enjoy the abundance of the kingdom. And I'm not just talking about material things. Now that abundance of peace and of joy. That laughter, or the fellowship, whatever it is. The abundance of healing that people experience. People are, oh, where's my healing? Yeah, where are you? In the whale or in the pigsty? Then we'll talk. You know? Come on. Come on, that's a good word right there. Where are you? You want your healing from inside the whale's belly? You want your healing from inside the pigsty? You got to get to that point of repentance and that point of acknowledging that your life is disgustingly bad when God is not involved. Verse 18, I will sit down and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, oh, Jesus, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son and threw his arms around him and kissed him. That's redemption. That's salvation. We can sing, Lord, I'm running to your arms, but guess what? He was running first. God was running before we took our first step in running. Because God's whole passion is his love for us. And his sadness is when we turn against that. His sadness is when we reject him. His sadness is when we reject the spiritual gifts as gifts. I mean, come on, who gives gifts back? You know, that's kind of weird. You know, it doesn't matter what, if people give you like a bubble gum, keep it, because it's free. Come on, who doesn't like free stuff here? But now I'm talking about the free stuff of heaven. The genuine stuff. The stuff that you cannot buy for $1 million. That stuff. And it's given to each one of us. Purpose. Direction. Peace. Joy. All of those things. This scene that we have here is not just Jonah saying, Lord, I'm sorry, then the whale spitting him out. It's not just a scene of a son who's feeling rejected and very sorry for himself, by the way. But the glory in these two stories goes to the Lord. The glory in these two stories about is actually the bottom line of the story is about God, who never turns his back on us.
Amen.
And that's the bottom line.
Amen.
It doesn't matter where we've been. It doesn't matter how far we've run. He's running to us. It doesn't matter what we've done and how much we've lied and how many excuses we've made. It's about him saying, okay, whales, put him out. And that is a story of redemption. I love the politician. Sorry, TJ. Each party has a good story to tell. The DA, a good story, just ANC, we've got a good story. No, God has the good story. That's a great story. One of redemption. One is saying, forget how you smell. You know, the whale stinks. The pigsty stinks. Forget that. And he's like this. I mean, I'm not, I don't want to have some of you. I'm going to be honest, I'll just put it out there right now. Yes. I don't want to hug some of you on a hot day. Maybe it's after we played hockey and stuff, I don't want to hug anyone. I said, yeah, don't hug me either. Cool, you'll stink. Come on, let's stay our distance. But that's not the kingdom way. Out of the belly of a whale, out of a pigsty, out of wherever, out of a swamp, out of mire, what is that verse, that song? Out of the miry clay, out of the mud. And he's standing there with arms wide open, waiting to just bring us back, waiting to pull us in. And that is why I'm saying stop running. Stop running because he's waiting for you. Stop running because he wants to love on you. Stop running because in your obedience, your joy will come. In your obedience, the fullness will come. So stop. Stop running. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, we just want to thank you for speaking to us. And we know, Lord, that your word never returns void. And we know, Lord, that your word is an on-time word. And I just pray today that this word will go deep. Deep into our thoughts, deep into our spirits, deep into who we are. We want to stop running from you, Lord. We want to stop disobeying. And we know, Lord, that at the other end of all that we've been doing is you. Standing with your arms wide open, waiting to embrace us. Waiting to just love on us. In Jesus' name we pray. In
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Turn it into dancing. You take my